discuss this fundamental idea without any instructions, which can be called global to local instructions. In this geometric setting, that's what I'm saying here, talking about it. But okay, so so recall that last time I stated something that I call surprising fact. Which are basically due to Ben's and Driftwood all of my leads presented. I don't know. So recall we talked about convolution, so that convolution. Is exact in the sense that observes reverse sheaves and is commutative.
I spent weeks doing this. I should have just.
But then there'll be I'll need another thing which I also mentioned last time, which probably might have didn't have a chance to discuss. So this is the Volkansky reagent based on the components. And so this is mentioned last time. Again, so this is categorification and, sorry, okay, so it's commutative and exact, and then as I discussed last time, I mean, at that point we know that this thing is a commutative monomial category. That's a category, and then it's identified in the representation. So, G of the Lanczel group, we talked about this, but now I want to address this specific point. And so, categorification of the center of the fine Penck algebra. Recall that, or rather, the isomorphism of the center of the fine Penck algebra is isomorphic to the sphere of Penck algebra. Discussed as isomorphic to the representation of the group. And so, let me state it as a theorem that there exists a central monoidal form term from the category of from this Sataki category to the Hecke category. Okay? And so lending, well, let's see. So it's monoidal category, but so Z lends in perverse sheaves, so Z sends. But I mean, the point is that the point is that it satisfies all exactness properties you can imagine. So the point is that I can say it's kind of it is a functor from perverse sheaves to perverse sheaves. But I can't say it preserves in tensor structure because rushes here, they don't have a tensor structure. You can convolve them inside here, but then you write it again something which is not perverse, but it doesn't happen with this case. So it's monoidal function to here to preserve the composition. It lands into perverse sheaves, and moreover, so C of F convolved with G is perverse.
And this I don't understand. Suppose you take two things, you say it's monoidal functor, so you can convolve them before or after you apply the function.
Yes.
And so therefore the convolution of the two things will go to will be against.
Yes, yes. No, absolutely. It's just yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm just saying it's if I take random objects here and convolve them, I will not get an object here, so I can't say it's a if I write it as an arrow like this, it's not an arrow between an arrow, okay? Anyway, I think we have the same page. I guess I call it this way. So, if for F in verbs for first mania, and so centrality means that Z of F involved G Z of F, and this isomorphism is factorial, of course, it satisfies compatibilities for G1 and G2. Okay, so there's some formal properties, but so they are all proved by kind of the same trick. And so I start with one, which is more fundamental and older. And again, so this is all about book groups. So you can think about it's something local happening on the formal one, this one point, but the construction, so these are local constructions for functors, properties. Some local categories of local nature. In the sense that there's maps from one to this. But the construction is local, because the construction uses global per. It doesn't matter which one, but again, it's only, basically we'll take a curve and we'll take a point there and only some neighborhood point will matter. So maybe the local is a Mastelian work, but anyway, we need some actual curve. And so I guess there is some just a vague way to motivate it from standard ideas in automorphic forms theory where of course, relations between the global and the local is central cornerstone of the theory. Maybe I'll say this later, so let me just first explain the key ingredient. And if you can, my office already covered it, is the global of Bendis and Bendis and Bendis Manion right, so
I covered it with notation. It's so covered with so much notation that's impossible.
Okay, so just to, and we'll do an example. So, okay, so first, what is it? It's kind of surprising when you see. Let C be a curve. Then, okay, one of them. Then, there is a God given international variety. Well, that's a different one. The canonical international variety in scheme. Something that you see, and it's a gadget which maps to C squared, so that for x, y, C squared, the fiber is identified with, in other two cases, girl, just one part of girl, if x is equal to y, and it's square of the girl's name if x is not equal. So this is kind of surprising, and suddenly if I stick in a finite variety instead of Grassmannian, that will never happen. But in fact, I mean, just infinite dimensional is something that's not. So, but of course, it's...
this is in some sense flat, right? This morph is
Yes, yes. Yeah. And it's not explaining what we're going to of course, it's exhaustive, but find dimensional varieties, and if you can write it this way, then it will be maybe less surprising. So, if you put here, you can like take the closure of the stratum, and then corresponding to two weights around the mu, then on the diagonal you get this closure of the stratum corresponding to something. But to make it less mysterious, let's do an example. Let's take G to be GLN. And and C be 1. And let's see for simplicity of notation. So girl will be just a set of lattices in a standard it's parameterized as M. So for just simplicity of notation, let me restrict attention to positive part of the Grassmannian, which is the set of lattices which are contained in the standard lattice. So L is an OR submodule of full rank. OR submodule. So of course the quotient would then be finite dimensional. Okay, then it gets really complete. So say we can stratify it by finite dimensional subspaces. So R plus. D just lattice of four dimensional D. And such a dimension. table. D, just to connect the point, which is a finite dimensional projective variety. And then, I can just consider the corresponding thing. The thing is like is this observation that a Gur plus D it can be thought of again as set sublattices in KFT to the hand. Just ideals, submodules in the free module of KFT. Which is the same as a set of submodules in the polynomial ring, just sheaves in the free right hand Kakian sheaf, so that the quotient is supported at zero, right? Then submodule. Dimension D such that KFT to the n mod lambda, I mean, the action of T here is important, in other words, it supports first algebra geometry, we can restate it by saying this is 0. This is quasi subtle. Subset. But now we can do the same thing. Not very clear how to define the thing, just say that by standard techniques of algebraic geometry, this data has a phi modular space, which is a factor of C square, and now the fiber is either real plus G1 times real plus G2 when two points differ, right? And it's real plus D when two. And so something like that happens. So you have to say the common words. I mean, really, I talked about this submodule just to simplify the wording, but in fact, what I really needed here is that, you know, just two lattices in the same thing. Just inside the other, so this leads to the following definition. So we told it to consider returning to the general situation, subgroup to C, it parameterizes the data of two points in C and a G bundle E. Such that plus a trivialization of E away from these two points. And so what people have checked is that this space and which is an instrument again, if you restrict the de facto of this isomorphism to two points, you get a point schema which maps with projection into C squared. All right, and so so how does it help to So maybe one thing which deserves addressing here is, let's discuss a little bit how canonical this is. I mean, this isomorphism of the fiber with product of the Riemannians is, and so for A1, you know, usually, coordinate can be made canonical, but in general, you can. So if you think of the Grassmannian, I mean, literally in this way, as lattices in a fixed space, I mean, so identification, the isomorphism. Depends on the choice on a local formal coordinate on the isomorphism of the completion. Grassmannian can be sort of constructed given a group and a local field, which is in principle isomorphic to the power series, but you don't need to fix this. And then I can just say that I guarantee copies of Grassmannian, which are attached to the fields, which are completions, or authorization of completions. But so now how does it apply to, how does it help to prove this fact?
That's just the definition. This is GR2C. That thing is the
this
definition.
Is the
yeah, okay.
So I claim that given two objects in my Satanti category. I claim that I can actually form a sheaf on this open part. And I can form and sort of take the external product, smear it around this group two, and form a sheaf. Maybe the cheapest way is to do it is to restrict stick to c equal to A1, where we have global coordinate, and then where we have really a global isomorphism, and use the isomorphism. Zero is just a diagonal. But this is a better way. I mean, this is using a necessary simplifying assumption. A better way is to observe. Say that. So the group of automorphisms of the Taylor series, right? So the group of reparametrizations of the form of this, it acts on the Grassmannian, and it happens so that each GO4 orbit is invariant under the detection law, just because it's it's fact-like. It's because clearly, it normalizes GO4, so it permutes GO4 orbit, but the self-form is being discrete, and they have to be preserved. But then, I mean, so now just that every the category. And this allows to form maybe I should bring it in. Okay, but either way, I mean, so that's all our problem. So the key point is that now I would claim that so just that convolution of two objects in our category so can be rewritten in this global to local way. So again, for this documentation, we can just restrict so we have this F. And yeah, again, let's just stick to V1. And let's even restrict to, so this is something on A1 square without diagonal, let's restrict it to fixed point. And then if we remove diagonal, I have to go up to 0. But now, so remember the discussion on the properties of the nearby cycles point. So then we are exactly in a situation where we can apply the functor. So this is some G. Primage of A1, A2, and so if I just use the projection to A1 as a function, then I can take this nearby cycle as well. Claim is that this is isomorphic to convolution. In fact, even maybe this is the way that there's an rhythmic problem, and then we get reabsorbed. Same proof that. Here we can't even, don't need to assume that F is G of 4 invariant. But then again, so the key point is that this is an this being exact functor, so this shows exactness. And then the construction is essentially symmetric. Well, I mean, there was this one last step restricting to 0 times A1, 0, which wasn't symmetric. But by and large, and in this picture is a symmetric respect to change of coordinates. So you can rewrite it as specialization to diagonal.
You could take any line through the origin.
Exactly, yeah. You can take not contained. Let's say a few words about why this is true. So idea of proof. So the point is that we have this Riesmanian, but remember, I mean, the convolution is defined using the this one. convolution diagram. Maybe in the example, in the GLN example,
wait, Roman, I'm still looking at it. Is equivariance in this category of perverse shapes, is that a structure or a property? That's in reference to the thing you just erased, but everything in
perverse. Right. In fact, it is a property, but yes, it requires a kind of Weyl's property, and it has to do with, so first we work with perverse shapes, and all. Yeah, if I want to work with the right category, then solve the question, and then that, you know, some action with the connected stabilizers. Well, in other words, you know, you have the equivariant category, you have the forgetful function on this classes of object, on the subcategory. Okay, so in the GLN example, what is it about? So remember, so we have this verb class. Describing this piece, which is a little bit psychologically a little bit easier to think about. Yes, and then this is just a set of all flexile lattices, right? So it's, instead of looking at the L1, L2, M, of course it's a submodule of the web, and here it's quadrimensional. And so you see it in this picture, right? It projects to, if I forget L1, it projects to the first factor. If I forget L2, it's this convolution map. Then there is this relative position for L1 and L2. So it's not exactly like L2. It's a sublattice somewhere. Now if I choose a basis in L2, I get an actual sublattice. Point in the Grassmannian, but one equivariant shape, you know, is going to have a sublattice in some. Okay, so, but now the point is that so we can modify, if you will, you can sort of partly resolve singularities to special fiber of SBR2. So, along with your can consider, well, I mean, bigger thing, another MLA, which is the same away from the diagonal. So let's do C2C. Which also maps to C2, and in fact, it maps properly to C2C. But, so this is isomorphism. So this is isomorphism over complement to diagonal. But over the diagonal, it's, it's just a convolution diagonal. So verb 2 C till XX is, well, it's again maps to verb 2 C XX, which is Grassmannian. But this is turns out to be the convolution diagram. So again, we kind of explain that. You can degenerate product of two Grassmannian into one Grassmannian, but instead we can do something which is, I guess, intuitively less surprising. We can degenerate the product of two Grassmannian into a twisted product of two Grassmannians. But then this kind of more intuitive degeneration maps to the less intuitive. Kind of more intuitive but less economical degeneration maps to the less intuitive but more economical degeneration. And, but okay, so so in the example, again, this would be, oh yeah, let me write first the general thing. So this will be what? So again, you'll have 2 points. Square. And then we'll have 2 bundles. One, two. And the data will be that E2 is trivialized away from x, say, c times x. But then E1 is, well, not quite trivialized, but identified with E2 away from y. So for our lattices, this would be what? This would be for ver plus Gn. We get something along the following lines. We'll get 2 points C2. Support of first quotient. Is x, and maybe I want the corresponding cycle. Fix. Okay, so yeah, I don't have to fix it. And then support of L1, L2 mod L1 is 1. Something like this. And then you immediately see that when x is equal to y, I get my convolution diagram, which I just described.
Is this description symmetric? So E2 is trivialized on the complement of x, E1 is also trivialized on the complement of y? Is that right?
No, now it's actually breaking symmetry. That's the whole point, that here we are breaking symmetry and somehow we get something which, you know, manifestly is not symmetric, but since we are able to rewrite this other way.
I see.
No, so it's really, you know, I can introduce E0 for the notation E0 for the trivial bundle. And then, yeah, if I just realize one, it will be not much, it will just that actual product. And here I want to give you this kind of twisted product. And then I can write, you know, E1 is identified with E0 away from y, and E2 is identified with E1 is identified with E2 away from y, and E2 is identified with E0 away from y. Okay, so and then the only so now we're going to just need to say magic words at the end. So first, by kind of looking at the local structure, intuitively that's really clear. So somehow we had this product and it degenerates into twisted product, so locally nothing is happening, and so when you take your bicycles in this situation, the street, also you get to natural expansion of the shape. And so this verb 2 C tilde is, well, it's cycling. My is quite more detailed, but anyway, so from the whatever it is some local argument. Argument says that psi, so you can now do on say t on your tilt c of f g is nothing but this twisted product which is used in the convolution diagram in the convolution. And the second point is, well, the psi commutes with proper derivative. So that's the theorem. Of course, we have. So maybe example of the situation is when G is also such G actually PG. Or in terms of G. And so I take this thing that I considered there, and let's just take D1 and D2 equal to 1. Then your plus 1 is P1 because it's all sublattices of four-dimensional 1 in here. So this is the same as this space line in the two-dimensional space of that modulus T. And so what is happening here is that you have this P1 to P1, or cos P1, degenerates into Herzog surface, surface S, which matches to P1. It's an electron, I guess. Objectivization of O plus 2. And that maps to. So this Hilbert surface is a piece in the convolution diagram, and the convolution map maps it to a surface with a quadratic cone singularity. Still, then this maps to S. So this is blows down P1, and then this develops it. So this is the same as lambda, where lambda is simple root of S2, weight 2. Okay, so and now so this was, I guess, discovered in the 90s. So maybe I should briefly say, so related ideas in mathematics. Okay, so I will try to make it short and narratively vague. So first thing is that the global to local in the automorphic forms theory. So global to local. So basically, if you consider the global automorphic space, so if you consider GA, product of gamma, so you get some module over the spherical Hanke algebras over the product of over x of places of your global field of spherical Hanke algebras. And the global reciprocity laws, they say that if you look for eigenvectors, common eigenvectors for this community algebras, well, you're going to get a lot, and then there will be some relations, I mean, between the eigenvalues, so between points in the maximal ideals, collection of maximal ideals of the spherical algebras that you get. And namely, the relation is that there should be, should correspond to eigenvalues of Frobenius for a Galois representation. But the point is that, right, Chebyshev density or something, so the action of spherical Hanke algebra, almost all points determine the action of the Frobenius. So this is, so I don't want to spend time stating the reciprocity laws, but just say that by reciprocity laws, in principle, a complicated procedure, the action of a spherical y not equal to x determines, well, say on a given common eigenvectors, determines the action of spherical x. But this is a global kind of construction, but somehow it passed to the geometric thing. It somehow did something like that. We used other nearby other points of our curve to describe the and take care operators there to kind of describe the product of the operators in our and there the construction was long.
This is a lot more concrete than this, in my opinion. Is there anything? Is there, is there anything of the kind that you can apply in the Hamiltonian situation? I mean, what you're saying is, correct me if I'm wrong, but I thought it's very, so what very ineffective, this sort of thing.
Oh, that's how you prove the local elements. You set up, you don't do it in the spherical case, you take a place where it's not, where it's arbitrarily ramified, and then you use some trace formula arguments to show that you can realize any local representation, essentially, and then you can track the behavior with respect to various operations at an unknown place by what you already know at the other place.
Yes. But anyway, so yes, I actually want. It's funny I'm mentioning it, although it may be vague, just to open discussion. And another thing is in a kind of different.
These are just functions.
Related in mathematics, and so continuistic fusion tensor product. I hope to be a little bit about this at hand. Fusion tensor product. On representations of affine the algebra, well, so this is a celebrated series of papers from the 90s. Again, if you look at the paper, the construction there also uses global curve, maybe global curve P1, and some conformal blocks construction to describe modules. So, I think Geisinger claims that there is a local construction. Modern techniques allow to write locally. In the same spirit. So again, so here we used. Now this product is called fusion. So again, the idea is that you put modules over 100 different points, and then you make these points collide. And how do you make them collide? So what kind of tools do you use to see what happens at this point? Collided. So again, in the construction that I presented, there was a nearby cycles function. So Cardanistic didn't have enough tools, so they kind of used the global curve and instead of making these points collide, they sort of used some global invariant to say what points collide. And again, so there's this now techniques of vertex agriculture, biological development now, which all do this. But again, so I like this topological picture. Have to use my cycle. Well, that is okay, so this is good. Now, now what about the center? So I guess that's the difference is how it's 90 exact date, but yes, so some good 10 or more years later, so was this discovery that you can do pretty easy modification for this construction. So modification. Yeah, it's almost trivial. You just take this E2 and you add a flat at a point. So let's just for economical, let's just restrict. So in rewrite this convolution is a theory with naming cycles we used. Now just modify it by add a flag at the fiber of E1 at 0. So it's some G torsor, technically I should fiber at 0 is a G torsor, technically I should say fix a reduction with G torsor to B torsor, but again, if I'm talking about lattices. Place one of the T and I fix it at 0. And the thing is that again, so Grossmannian can be G bundles trivialized away from the point, and a fine flex space can be thought of as. Point. define flex space is just G bundles with a flag at the point. I mean, same thing plus a flag at the point. And then you just do the same thing. So then, I mean, this thing maps to flow. So it maps to A1 and the fiber away from. To define my functor, I just take here the unit object, the spacecraft point times z times g of f subside with respect to t of delta function point times f. And all these properties, the magic properties as I stated, they also rely on pretty similar arguments. But again, the point is that you can rewrite the convolution with that thing as nearby cycles. You know, now you can stick in here instead of this, you can stick any arbitrary shape, and take nearby cycles. And this nearby cycles function will be the same as convolution with that thing. And it's exact and it's essential. Okay, so I guess I should be. Maybe one example.
There must be something that makes it harder than the.
I think it's just technically, I think it's just this.
Oh, not even a local computation? Because when I saw this rather quickly when it came out, I said, well, it's probably just the same as the other one, but now having actually spent some time looking
at
it.
Well, okay, so. I mean, there was a specific issue that we discussed about. Okay, so one example. So let's again take G to be GL2 and lambda to be to F to be in this constant shape on in this P1 that we already discussed. And so in this diagram, so when we have this degeneration, so here I take one and here I take the point. So basically I'm having, so I have some family where generic fiber is P1. So what's going to be its special fiber? Well, there's not much choice, but again, so of course it's just P1 degenerating into a cross. And so you'll get computing the nearby cycles for that special situation, well, it's called Kardashev's theory. It's a simple, non-trivial example of that. So there will be some nearby cycle shift that you can describe. Of course, it will be constant away from a single point, but something, you know, somewhat non-trivial will be happening at this point. Of course, the vanishing cycles function will be exactly one-dimensional, so it will differ from the constant shift, will be exactly one vanishing cycle, so this nearby cycle shift will differ from the constant shape inside one dimensional space, but you can kind of, in this shape game, you can express it by writing an exact triangle. So you can take the zero extension of C from one line, and then you get the star extension from another line, and this will be exact. So as an object in this category, it's kind of not so trivial. I mean, it has length 4. So this has length 2, this has length 2. They draw the earlier series of one constant shift. You have one delta function at the top and one delta function in the middle, then you have two constants. Sokol is the delta function, also the delta function, you have two constants. So, okay, so I should be right now, but so what? Next, I'll return to this. Next time, I want to look at this Z of F in more detail. In particular, recall that the center of the Fine-Hinkey algebra is contained in this toric subalgebra in C of F. And so I'll all the fundamental ideas are already here, but so then will be some reasonably easy argument categorifying this and the embedding, and then from this we'll be able to unravel, you know, the structure of this and find a category and its description in the Lemmas-Dole terms. Yeah, this also be related to the description of fiber front in terms of orbits and all that, and then to most applications in other branches of representation. And maybe later we'll discuss place larger lines.
May I ask one question? Yeah. So it seems like from this global Grassmannian, you have, if you flow from a general fiber to a fiber over the diagonal, you get a sort of homotopy. Well, up to homotopy, you get some kind of binary operation on the affine Grassmannian.
Right.
But it's also homeomorphic to the loop group of the compact.
Exactly. Yeah, that's a good point.
Is it the same as the group operation on the compact?
Yes. I actually. Right. I mean, that's actually. Does clarify a lot. So as you might have said, so you can identify, you know, if you read or receive. This is polynomial loops into the maximal compact, you know, as a real space. And actually, because it's kind of arises as LK. So these are free loops, which is a compact form of the loop, which is robotic. And yes, so this is just a group, and the homotopy structures, homotopically, that's the same thing that you get from this family. And in fact, you can even define convolution as in this way. Earlier program in principle. You. And it's actually also ties nicely with this more general story, because so you have this algebraically, you have this flex Grassmannian with a fiber G of E definition. And really what happens here, if you restrict inside here, you can just take the time dimension. And then what you conclude is that you have a family where generic fiber is Grassmannian times G of B, and it degenerates into the fiber, right? And if you think about it, it's kind of weird, because you have a family of vibrations where generic fiber is trivial and the special fiber is non-trivial. That's not something.
Solve the time of algebra too.
Well, yes, but one thing to say is that this is only possible. Yeah, but not. Yeah. Not in the first class. First class is kind of seeing the opposite situation. But in particular, this is only possible because this vibration is topologically trivial.
Right.
If it wasn't, then it would be an abstraction. Yes. And so this is topological trivial, and why is it topological trivial? Exactly because you can also say that this fragment is LK in T, it's omega K times.
Thanks.